sur Camel. Audrey, Linda, mets 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 sur Camel. Feed our people with the rod of no cooked and heritage. Audrey, solitary in the wood, in the midst of Carmel. Audrey, 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 in the midst of Carmel.
Mark chapter 12, verse 29. And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely this, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. Matthew 22:35. Then one of them which was a lawyer asked him a question, tempting him, and said, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? A lawyer asked Jesus. In Mark, we read that lawyer was also a scribe. A scribe, come a lawyer. He knew every word, every punctuation, every dot and every dash very well. In Hebrew language, we don't have punctuations as we have in our English or in Tamil. But in Hebrew language, every dot, every dash is very important. That would even change the whole meaning, a dot or a dash. My dear brother, my dear sister, he knows the law very well. He knows how to interpret the law. He was not just asking a question of knowledge. He was trying to tempt Jesus. The word is very powerful. He wanted to pull Jesus into a mistake. The word tempting is to make someone fall, to make someone mistake, to make someone commit a mistake, to make someone fall, tempting, to make someone sin. He was tempting Jesus. In Greek, the same word is used to make Jesus fall. And we should know this background very well. When we read from verse Matthew chapter 22 verse 15, then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. The very purpose of these questions were to entangle him in talk. And this in Mark chapter 12 verse 13 we read, and they said unto him, certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians, to catch him in words. To catch him in words. Mark 12:30. Jesus said, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. In verse 33, that lawyer responded, and to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love his neighbor as himself, is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. More than all burnt offerings and all sacrifices. More than anything what the religion could bring. Love God, love your neighbor. Love God, love yourself, love your neighbor. There's nothing greater than this in any religion. Christianity is not a religion. If we want to understand Christianity in the words of Jesus Christ, the religious part of Christianity, love God, love yourself, love your neighbor. It is greater than all the other things. It is greater than baptism. It is greater than doing a formal ministry. It is greater than some dedications. It is greater than all sacrifices and offerings. Love God, love yourself, love neighbor. Probably you'll understand that you should love God, you'll understand that love your neighbor, and add to it, love yourself. That's very, very important. The problem is we don't love ourselves. Because we don't love ourselves, we don't love God, we don't love our neighbor. Because loving God is in us. I'm going to deal with a very, very difficult subject in this morning. Probably with all humility I can say, the toughest subject ever I personally faced. May the Lord give me the enough grace, the words, the unction that I would be able to reach you. Maybe it may be very simple for some of you. With all humility, I would like to tell you, I'm going to deal with one of the toughest subjects I ever handled. How is loving God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength? Hours and hours and hours I was spending on understanding this passage. When I was trying to understand this passage, I understood that many great giants have failed to understand this passage. And what mountains cannot do, what a mole can do. But however, as I am able to have a picture of this verse, the totality of this verse, I love to share with you with all my humility. My dear brother, my dear sister, first I want to understand what a heart is. The Hebrew word for heart, I find, lev, is from the Hebrew word
Laban.
What is it? Lev means literally inner parts, midst, or center. And the Greek word for hot is chordia. And the Hebrew word lev, used in our Old Testament, for about 593 times, approximately 600 times. And the Greek word chordia is used for 160 times. But these two words are translated with the different shades of meaning. When we understand chordia, mostly we understand a human organ called heart. Like we have got lungs, we have got intestines, we have got kidneys or spleen. There is one organ almost in the middle of our body. It is called heart. My dear brother, my dear sister, but not only it speaks about this human inner organ, heart. Heart speaks about different things. So I just wanted to know what is the first place this word heart appears. This word heart appears in Genesis 6:5 for the first time in the Old Testament. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart, every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. So it was given in the negative connotation in book of Jeremiah. Every heart is a froward heart. It is not that human organ, but the every imagination of the thought of his heart. So there is a metaphysical place where the imagination of the thought is. If somebody is finding it difficult to catch up, please bear with me, but I love to reach every one of you. So what do I mean by a metaphysical part? A physical part is the organ heart. A metaphysical part, it's not a physical one, it's a metaphysical. So every imagination of the thought is in that heart, in that metaphysical heart. And every imagination of the thought of that metaphysical heart is evil. It's evil. It's the process of a fallen man. And in the next verse, the second time that word appears, Genesis 6:6, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. God is spirit. There is no physical chordia for him. But there is a spiritual heart for him. That heart was spirit. God was spirit. That heart was spirit. So that heart was grieved. That heart was grieved. In the same Genesis chapter 8 verse 21, the same contest after the days of Noah. And the Lord smelled the sweet savor, the sacrifice of Noah. And the Lord said in his heart. So God is spirit. God is able to speak to his heart. God said in his heart. Heart is the seat of imagination of the thought. Heart is the seat of the imagination of the thought. I'm not sharing this from any book. A couple of days back, probably after we had a heavy day on December 25 at our Sayar ministry, we came back around 12:30. We reached home. morning by 7:30, I sat on my chair. Except for my lunch break, till 12 in the midnight, maybe around 17 hours, I was glued to my seat. Even sister affectionately annoyed, "Why are you sitting like this?" Then he may ask me what happened to the breakfast. I had the breakfast by my side, eating the breakfast and continuing my meditation. Why I say this is not only to share with you, with the pain I was meditating this. I must love you with all my heart, then I must understand what my heart is. It is a realm of the imagination of thought. It is the source of all my thoughts. The imagination of source of my thoughts. So God said in his heart, in his thought process, God said, what did God say? In his thought process, God said, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. Where did he say this? He said this in his heart. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth, from the beginning. The imagination, so imagination in man's heart. Neither will again smite anymore everything living as I have done. So I wanted to know where it appears in the New Testament. The word heart appears in Matthew 5:8 at the first instance. Blessed are the pure in heart. In the Old Testament, a sinful man, the first occurrence, every imagination of the thought of man's heart is evil. And the first occurrence, God said that. God said that. In the New Testament, God says, blessed are the pure in heart. What should be pure in heart? Every thought of the imagination. Every thought of the imagination. My dear brother, my dear sister, every thought of the imagination is evil. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. Every thought of the imagination is evil. Every imagination of the thought is evil. And the Lord says in the New Testament, pure in heart, purity in the thought, in the imagination of the thought. Purity in the imagination of the thought. My dear brother, my dear sister, so what is this heart? Heart is the seat where we have the imagination of the thought. And this imagination of the thought creates a lot of emotions in our life. The imagination of the thought creates a lot of emotions in our life. We get fear, we get love, we get courage, we get anger, we get joy, we get sorrow, we get hatred. All these things spring forth from our heart. From our heart. My dear brother, my dear sister, when I was meditating, this is what I could understand. People are talking about heart attack, cardiac arrest, heart failure. For all those things, mostly the doctor says, be careful about worries. Be careful about your stress level. Tension. Be careful about tension. the blood pressure. My heart rejoices, my heart fainting. So literal meaning, or rather the way that I understand, any of your stress or any of your emotions that can influence your physical heart, anything that could make your heart rejoice, anything that could make your heart green, anything that could strengthen your physical heart, anything that could weaken your physical heart, those emotions. In a simpler word, what you imagine, what you think, how you understand a situation. As I said earlier, how do you perceive this? How do you look at it? What is your perception about it? Every coin has got two sides. How do you perceive? How do you interpret a situation? I said many times, the positive perception, the negative perceptions, all those things trigger our emotions. All these things trigger our emotions. My dear brother, my dear sister, tension. But God is overall, God is in control, God knows everything. That soothes our heart. I imagine, the imagination of my thought, the imagination of my thought, God is overall. God is overall. God knows it. God is in control. I imagine, the imagination of my thought brings faith in my life. So with all my emotion, I love God. Love God with all your emotion. In a simpler way, when you pray, tears must come. When you pray, rejoicing must come. When you read the Bible, tears must drop on the pages of the Bible. My dear brother, my dear sister, nowadays, mostly because of my sight problem, I use this electronic Bible. When I was using this paper Bible, many pages, there will be drops of tears. But I am not a match to many great saints, stalwarts. I was listening, somebody is sharing a testimony of a great servant of God, and an Emil Jabesing, who was the greatest motivation for me for my mission activities. Our Emil Jabesing, they say, every year he has to change the Bible, because most of his Bible, most of his pages, because of the tears which have fallen on those pages, would have made those papers not usable for the second time. Every year he has to buy a new Bible. This has been my practice some years back. When I was hearing about Anand Emil Jabesing, I said, revive my spirit, O Lord. I have decided to buy a new Bible. Not just for the sake of buying a new Bible, but I want to soak my Bible again with tears. That emotion, that imagination, God is with me. God will not forsake me. Let come what may. God will see me through. God will take care of me. Many situations came in my life. My dear brother, my dear sister, it was in the year 1990, August 29th. When we were to take a very hard decision. No job, no income, no house. Sister and I, we didn't have an idea where I could keep my books. Not only shelter for our sister and I and for our children, where to keep my books. What you see is half of what I had earlier. Most of the books walked away. My dear brother, my dear sister, I wept at the feet of the Lord. God never forsook me. When there seems no way, God opened up a way. Emotionally loving God. God will not leave me. God will not forsake me. Just imagine the situation. There is nothing to eat next day. We don't know where we will stay. How am I going to end for my family? God is a witness, sister is a witness. Probably that pastor whom I shared this, he is a witness. I said, from tomorrow I'm going to drive auto rickshaws. I mean, not exactly tomorrow. What's next? I'm going to drive auto rickshaws to earn money for my family. I imagined the imagination of my thought. My God loves me. Sorrow, fear. If I say lie, I'll go to hell. Fear, anger. See, so many times we tell these people they don't honor God. They are unable to keep up the time. That anger must come. They are not obeying God. They are not honoring God. How will God bless them? In the business of God, they are slothful. The Bible says, cursed is the man who is slothful in God's business. கர்த்தருடைய வேலை அசதியாய் செய்கிறவன் சபிக்கப்பட்டவன். யோ தீஸ் கேர்ள்ஸ், தீஸ் பாய்ஸ், தே ஆர் நாட் வெரி, ஐ மீன் தே ஆர் டு தே ஆர் வெரி லெத்தாஜிக் இன் காட்ஸ் வர்க். கர்ஸ் ஆஃப் காட் வில் கம் அப்பான் தம். தட் ஆங்கர் மஸ்ட் கம், தட் ஃபியர் மஸ்ட் கம். ஓ, ஐ வில் கோ டு ஹெல் இஃப் ஐ ஸ்பீக் லைஸ், ஐ வில் கோ டு ஹெல் இஃப் ஐ ஸ்பீக் லைஸ். தட் ஆங்கர் மஸ்ட் கம், தட் ஃபியர் மஸ்ட் கம். That courage must come. Let come what may. Let come what may. My dear brother, my dear, it's a very sad thing. Nearly 35 families at one part of our ministry left us. Still yesterday I prayed, Lord, if something wrong in me, please forgive me. When we were praying, I prayed, Lord, if anything wrong for people have left us, forgive me, Lord. Bring them back. They are still coming back. Bring them back. My dear brother, my dear, but there is a courage. Faithful is he that has called me. That's not arrogance. Courage. Courage. When 35 people, most of the tithe payers, they stopped. We didn't stop the love feast. We didn't stop the electricity. We didn't stop paying our staff. We didn't stop eating. Nothing was stopped. That's the courage. God is with me. Why should I fear man? That's not arrogance. With all humility, I tell you, that courage, fear, anger, joy, sorrow. When you think about God, tears must come in your eyes. Your heart must be grieved when you see people are not, or people are in sin. When you see somebody away from God, your heart must be broken. My dear brother, my dear sister, that is loving God with your heart, loving God with all your emotions. Pastor Sundaram, he used to say, I learned from him not to use that word merry. Merry is fun and frolic, influenced by intoxication, mostly by wine. The fun and frolic of an intoxicated drunkard. The fun and frolic of a drunkard is merry. Merriment, merry. Joy is different. Gladness is different. Happiness is different. Merry is different. Merry is because of reviling. All the revilers will not go to heaven, the Bible says. Merry in Tamil, Kaliyattu. Those indulge in Kaliyattu will not go to heaven. This first time, not from Webster's, not from Oxford, not from Cambridge, not from Longman, I learned this word from Pastor Sundaram. He taught everybody. He taught the whole congregation, not only to Sister Premi and not only to Premi and Robert Simon. He didn't talk this in chamber. He talked that in the pulpit. I remember I went and verified that word in the dictionary. What does that word Mary means? For the first time I heard it from Pastor Sundar. Now, in that congregation, those who heard it from his own lips, his own blood, he is sending Merry Christmas. Hearts are broken. It's not they didn't know, it's not they don't know English. Somebody who doesn't know English properly, if they say, oh, Happy Christmas or Merry Christmas or Joyful Christmas, maybe one and the same. But somebody who has heard Pastor Sundaram, somebody who knows English, if they say Merry Christmas, sister heart was broken. Again and again she was saying, what happened? How could they, those who heard these words, how could they use these words? What do I mean? We must get that holy sorrow. We must get that holy anger. We must get that holy courage. We must get that holy fear. We must get that holy gladness. We must get that holy joyfulness, that loving God with all our heart. When he says Mary, let him say Mary. Those who come late, let them come late. Those who pay tithe, let them pay tithe. Those who don't pay tithe, they need not pay tithe. I'll just preach, I'll just come, I will go. I'm not loving God with emotion. I'm not loving God with all my heart. I say I love God. But I don't, if I love God, I must get anger, I must get fear. He will go to hell. She will go to hell. Curse will be upon her because she is not doing God's duty properly. That fear must come. Then I love God with all my heart. If there is no reaction in my heart, when people do something good or people do something bad, I don't love God with all my heart. My dear brother, my dear sister, there was a great theologian by name John Owen. Only many Christians call by the name Owen because of John Owen. The greatest theologian of the English Puritan movement, it is called. Who possessed the finest theological mind that England ever produced. So John Owen says, the heart in scripture is variously used, sometimes for the mind and understanding, sometimes for the will, sometimes for the affections, sometimes for the conscience, sometimes for the whole soul. Generally, it denotes the whole soul of man and all the faculties of it, not absolutely, but as they are all one principle of moral operations, as they all concur in our being of good and evil. If you love God with all your heart, you must be able to draw a line. This is good, this is evil. This is right, this is wrong. It should grieve your heart. Evil should grieve your heart. Good should make your heart rejoice. Then you are loving God with all your heart. When you can't rejoice when there is something good, when you cannot grieve when something evil, you are not loving God with all your heart. My dear brother, my dear sister, with all humility I tell you, As I said earlier, I'm handling one of the most toughest passages in the Bible, but surely the Lord will help you. It is a siege of affection, both evil and good. Your love for evil, your love for good, your anger for good, your anger against good, your anger against evil. The father chides the child. The father is angry because of the evil of the child. The child is angry because of the good of the father. Can you understand now? That's hard. The father is angry because the child made a mistake. Chided at the child. Shouted at the child. Now the child is angry because the father was good. Because the father was trying to correct the child. Pastor is angry because something was going wrong. He shouts at those people. And the people are angry because pastor is correcting them. Everything is in the heart. Whether the imagination of the thought is good or the imagination of the thought is bad. Now just imagine there are two boys. Bala, Babu. Two boys, Bala, Babu. I shouted both of them. Bala, Babu, they come late. I shouted both of them. Hey, Bala, hey, Babu. Why did he come late? I shouted them. Now, the reaction of Balu is, pastor is loving me. Pastor is trying to correct me. He imagines it's only for my good. I can remember it for the future. Whenever Pastor Sundara made a correction, I remember it now. I shared it with many of my believers. I mean, many of my brothers. So Bala thinks it's for my good. Babu thinks, why is this man so angry? He's a very bad man. He doesn't like me. So for my same act, two people have the imagination of thought in a different way. Why are the imagination of their thoughts are different? Because of their heart. One's heart is good, he is able to perceive it in the positive way. One's heart is evil, he is able to perceive it in the negative way. Why should he shout at me? Why should he say like this? That is heart. So when God's matter, when these reactions come in your heart, if all those anger, sorrow, gladness, everything is good, your heart is good. You are loving God with all your heart. If those positive emotional changes are not in you, when you see evil or good, then you are unable to love your heart. You are unable to love God with all your heart. May the Lord help us understand this better. And the second one, love God with all your soul. Heart is the seat of emotions. Now what is the soul? The Hebrew word for soul is nephesh, and the Greek word for soul is psyche. From that only we get psyche, psychology, psychiatrist, etc. And the Latin word for soul is anima. From that only we get the word animal. Animal. So what is the soul? In Hebrew it is nephesh. In Greek it is psyche. And Latin it's anima. Soul is nothing but the living being. Soul is the life. Soul is the self. Soul is the person. Soul is the personality. Soul is the person. Admi. Atma. From Atma we get Admi. The first occurrence in Genesis 2:7, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Soul makes a man live. Soul makes a man live. In Matthew 10:28, the very beautiful passage, there's the first occurrence of soul in the New Testament, the suke in New Testament. And fear not them which kill the body, which kill the body. In the Old Testament, in Hebrew, there is no word for body. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul. So soul is inside. They can kill the body, but the soul will continue to live. But rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. So both will go to hell. Soul can go to hell, your body can go to hell. So soul is nothing but your personality, your ego, yourself. I explained this word ego many a time earlier. Ego is nothing but you know who you are. That's your psyche. I know that I am a pastor. I know that I am a man. I know that I am a human being. I know that I come from Tirunelveli. I know that I am an Indian. I know my language is Tamil. I know that I got this, I studied these things. I know so many things. I know whose husband I am. I know who all our children. I know about myself. I get a lot of other emotional changes because I know who I am. Please listen, in the church, if something goes wrong, if the PA system holds, I immediately look at him. Hey, what happened? Those are helping us in the ministry, musicians, our choristers, or somebody comes late, we get angry because I know that I am a pastor. Because I know that I am a pastor, I get angry. When I go to another church, yes choir or no choir, the mic is good or bad, whether they arrange the chairs properly or not, do I get angry? Why do I get angry here? When somebody does something wrong, you may not be angry. When your own child does the same thing, you'll be angry. Because I know that I am a pastor here, and I know that I am not responsible of that congregation. That is the soul. I know who I am. I know who I am. If I don't know who I am, I become psyche. There's some problem with my psyche. Psychotic. So I have to go to a psychiatrist. So psychology is the behavior of science. Why I behave like this? Why I get annoyed here? That annoyed is from the heart. When I find an answer, why I get annoyed? Because I love God. Because I love my congregation. Because I got a responsibility towards my people. I'm not worried about, I'm worried about the individuals, but I have to be very cautious about the institution. Individuals make an institution. It's a very big, difficult thing to balance between the individuals and the institution. My dear brother, my dear sister. So what do we understand by soul? The word nefesh is found more than 753 times in the Old Testament. And suki were about 105 times in the New Testament. So you should differentiate between soul and spirit. What do we understand by soul and spirit? John 19:30. Jesus gave up his ghost to the Father. Jesus gave up his ghost. That is the spirit. Pneuma. Pneuma. Verse 15, chapter 10. Jesus gave his life for the sheep. It's not only he gave up his spirit for the sheep. His very life, his pain, his he knows that he is God. He knows that he is God. He knows that he is the Son of God. He knows that he and Father are one. He knows that he that seeth him seeth the Father. He knows that he that receiveth him receiveth the Father. He knew that he was equal to God. That was his soul. And he gave up that soul. It's not that just he died as a criminal. He knew that he was God and he died for his sheep. He knew that he was the true shepherd. He died on the cross. He gave up his personality. He gave up his life. He gave up spirit to the Father. He gave up his ghost to the Father. He gave his spirit to the Father. He gave his soul to the people. He gave his soul to the people. My dear brother, my dear sister, nefesh or suki can only denote the individual life being with a material, within a material organization, a life within this body, this clay mold, a personality. Something is living within me. Something that makes me king, something that makes me slave. Something that makes me slave. Something makes me king. Something makes me proud. Something makes me ashamed. Something makes my heart rejoice. Something makes my heart grieve. Who is that something? That is my soul. That decides my behavior. Proverbs 11:17. The merciful man doeth good to his own soul. When I show mercy, when I do certain things, I do good to my soul. The cruel man destroyeth. The cruel man destroyeth his own flesh. He troubleth his flesh. My dear brother, my dear sister, soul decides my behavior. Why I weep, why I am angry, why I am sad. I am angry, that's in my heart. But why I am angry, when I find an answer to that why, that is my soul. That is my personality. So I love God with all my personality. I should be angry. I know whether he is rich or he is poor. And I know how to handle the educated man, how to handle the uneducated man. What type of words I should use to train this man? What should a word I should use to train that man? My behavior. But my intention is the same. How to take the rice out of the, how should I do with the wheat? How should I do with the rice? How should I treat a green dal or a black dal? We read in Isaiah chapter 28. The cumin seed, how should I treat? I must have a behavior. Okay, this is a very, I have to be very soft with this person. I have to be very harsh with this person. My behavior changes, but my intention is the same. That is my soul. I love God with all my behavior. I love God with all my behavior. My behavior, my actions suggest I love God. As I said earlier, we can't find much difference between heart and soul. Heart is the seat of emotion, and soul decides your behavior because of the result of that emotion. May God help us. And number three, let me go quickly, the mind. In another place, that lawyer used a different word for mind, understanding. The reasoning power, the rationalizing faculty. The word mind is disneo. I'm sorry, Dionio. There is no Hebrew word much equivalent to this mind. The Greek word suggests imagining, thinking, understanding, desiring. Desiring. I desire to go to heaven. We desire to prepare, make ready a people prepared for the Lord, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Our desire, that's our goal, that's in our mind. Because that's in your mind, when somebody goes wrong, we are grieved. Because we are grieved, we shout at that person. Mind, soul, heart. Mind, soul, heart. I rationalize. If this child does the work of the Lord in a slothful way, this child will have a curse. If this brother does the work of the Lord in a slothful way, he will have a curse. That's my mind. I know the Bible. There is a reason. I rationalize. If so and so does the work of the Lord in a slothful way, he will have a curse. Because I know that he will have a curse, there is, I am grieved in my heart. There is sorrow in my heart. I move to tears. I move to anger. I move to fear. Because of the fear in my heart, I shout at that person. I react. I behave. I behave. In all these areas, should love God. My reasoning power, based on the love of God, is not based on my personal gain. It's not based on my personal gain. I remember very well, one Sunday morning, my heart was very much grieved. People are coming late, even those who were helping us in the ministry. We just heard a song. We had a very big music team at that time. Some musician was missing. We started with one song. When the song was over, I started with a message. There are two different types of churches. One is called an Episcopal church, one is called a Congregational church. In an Episcopal church, it's like Roman Catholic or CSI and some of the Pentecostal churches, there is a system. This is how you should dress. This is how the pastor should enter in. This is how he should bow before he goes to the table. This is how he must have his fingers when he was pronouncing the benediction. Everything is tailor-made. If he has to have his fingers like this, he must have his fingers like that. That is Episcopal. In Congregational church, it's most based on the leader. It's not necessary that I should start preaching after having two lyrics, one hymn, and then Bible reading, etc. As the Lord leads, or as I decide, the leader. So after the song, I started with a message. It hurt one brother. Next week he didn't come to the church. When I came to know that he was not attending the church, I called him. Very affectionately I called him. Very lovingly I called him. I said, "Brother, what happened?" He said, "I want to go to a better church." I said, "Yes, brother, I'll continue to love you." My dear brother, my dear sister, at that time, he was the highest tithe payer. I loved him, but I didn't want to compromise. That's my behavior. It's not because of his money. It's not because of his money. But I want to. I love God. I love God. I can't afford to access somebody who is slothful in the ministry. It's not that I don't love that person. I try to correct that person. He doesn't want that correction. He is matured enough to make his own choice. The youngest son of that man He is matured enough to make his own choice. The father was not stopping him. That brother, that family made a choice. And they felt bitterly bad later for the choice they made. Till this day they say that. Why do I say this? Our mind has got a reason that should love God. It should not love money. It should not love the tithe. It should love the tithe payer, not the tithe amount. It can't be one rule for the rich, one rule for the poor. My dear brother, my dear sister, there's a mind. Love God with all your mind. Lord, I love you. In you, I love people. I don't love money. One of the brothers is a witness. There was an allegation against a poor boy. He was very poor at that time. Three people came to talk to me about them. Those three are very rich. I loved all the four. But I didn't love their money. One of the brothers is here now. Why do I say this? Your mind, your reasoning is to love God. Your reasoning to love God must create emotions. That's your heart. That emotions which create because you love God should decide your behavior. So love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. So when that behavior, it should not be half of the effort. It should be a full effort. Do your best. I love God. I want to serve the Lord. That courage is in me. Let come what may. I got a reason. God will not leave me. I imagine. My mind says, God will not leave me. That creates a courage in me. I resign my job. I come out. I didn't look to anybody. It's not to speak about me. Please bear with me to help you understand what is that strength. Do it in full strength. Do it in full strength. I'm not expecting Pastor Sundaram would help me. I'm not expecting our relatives would help me. God is a witness. Not one paisa from any of our relatives we received when we came for the ministry. Not from any of our relatives, neither from her relative or not from our relative. They all are well placed. Nobody. March, I gave my resignation. June, I was relieved. June, July, August. Wonderful time. So my reasoning gave courage in my heart that decided, that reflected in my behavior, and we could see the strength in that behavior. With all my strength, God has called me. Let come what may. When you give to the Lord, you want to give to the Lord, give with all your strength, with all your might. When we want to sing, sing with all your might. If you faint, let me faint on the singing. If I preach, let me faint on my preaching. Not once, not twice, many times I have seen that. Many times I have seen that. Last Sunday morning, when I was coming here, when I was preparing Saturday evening, I had a very hectic day. I knew it was my last message. 11 o'clock Saturday evening, night. I could not continue. I know very well I should get up at 3 o'clock. I went, washed my face, refreshed up. I must come and sit. It's not that I want to spend 1 hour. Anything I can speak and go. My dear brother, my dear sister, full strength. If at all this is the last sermon, let me finish this last sermon and die. My dear brother, my dear sister, 2 days back, 17 hours I was sitting. I know this may be lost my preparation. Even I thought within me, I don't know whether I would deliver it or not. At least I have spoken to myself. Do it with all your strength. That is loving God. Now there are two things. I just finish it. I wanted to have a big story, but I don't have time. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You should love yourself. What is really loving yourself? You imagine, if I do this, I will go to hell. If I speak lie, I will go to hell. If I give room for lust of the youth, I will go to hell. Do you really love yourself? If you really love yourself, your behavior will change. We don't love ourselves. We love sin. We love evil. We love bad things. We don't love ourselves. That man possessed with a legion of evil spirits, he didn't love his body. He was hurting his body with stone. You are hurting yourself with pornographic movies. You are hurting yourself with evil chattings. You love bad things. You love evil things. You love fornication. Boys, girls, brother, women, men, that eros, that type of a carnal attraction, you love that, and you want to outwardly holy, but the inside, you don't love corrections. You don't love anybody correcting you. You don't mind going to hell. You don't have fear when you read the Bible. You could not understand God's warnings. Those who do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. You are not worried about it. Those who are slothful, cursed will be. Those who are slothful, cursed is he that is slothful in God's business. Kartrudi veli asadiya seigran sabikkapattavan. Ayyo, God will curse me. You don't mind that. You don't love yourself. You love sleep. You love movies. You love friends. You love merrymaking, merriments. Really, do you love yourself? Have you got an emotional love for your being? A fear, a joy, a gladness. Many people don't love themselves. It's a very sad thing. Because they don't love themselves, they don't love others. They don't love others. Those who can't love themselves can never love others. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Somebody who doesn't know to love himself, how will he love others? If you don't love your son, your daughter, can you really love somebody else? You are not worried about the salvation of your son. You are not worried about the salvation of your daughter. You are not worried about the salvation of your children. You are not worried about the salvation of your parents. And you say that you are worried about the salvation of somebody else. Is that true? The Christian love is a true love of the self. I don't have love for money, but I love that I should inherit the eternal life. Any funeral of a servant, I run. Let me hear something. I must go to heaven. My life must be shaped by that person. The other day I was attending a funeral of a great servant of God. He has written so many books. Lord, he has given me grace to write. I have written only one book, Lord. Lord, how am I wasting my time? Give me grace. I want to be in the center of God's will. I want to gain my soul. I gain the whole world, and if I lose my soul, what profit is me? If I stand and preach from the pulpit and go to hell, what is the use of this preaching? You do singing, or you play on the instruments, or you do the web streaming, or you do the recordings, and if you can't save your soul, what is the use of your ministry? Love yourself. Fear the hellfire. Fear the hellfire. Number three, I want to explain how you have to love yourself with your soul, with your spirit, with your mind, with your strength. And when you love yourself, love others. Love your neighbor. I want to explain in length how to love the neighbor, how to love yourself. But I just conclude with a matrix of life. Some time back, I preached a very famous sermon, Matrix of Life, Baldwin Uruvare. Be a neighbor to somebody who is in need. I just say these four things. He saw the man wounded, dying on the Jericho road. He was moved with compassion. There's a love of heart. There's a love of heart. His mind said, he is a Jew. He's coming from Jerusalem. He calls me an untouchable. He hates me. I am a Samaritan. Let this fellow die. Even God, whom he is worshipping, is not helping him. Why should I help him? But overcoming all these reasons, the mind says, he is a human being. He is dying. Whether he is a Jew or not, I must help. That's the love of his mind. He got down from his vehicle, went to him, poured in the oil and the wine. That's the love of his behavior. He did all what he could do. He was on a journey. The Greek word means he is going from one place to another place with a purpose. In spite of that, he broke his journey. He carried that man. Put him on his own vehicle. Took him to an inn. Talked to the innkeeper. Paid some money. Made a promise, if there is anything extra when I come back, I will pay. With all his strength, his compassion, when he saw a wounded man, that was his heart. His reason, whosoever this may be, he might have been a Jew who hurt me. He might have been a Jew who says I am untouchable. He may not even allow me to touch him now. He may not accept the wine I give. He may not allow me to give wine to him. In spite of, I must do something to him. That is mind. That made him get down from his vehicle. Went to that man. Poured in the oil and the wine. Dressed up his wounds. His behavior. His personality. That is his life. That is that Samaritan. He's not worried who my neighbor is. He wanted to be the neighbor of somebody who is suffering. He didn't stop with it. He did his best to help him with all his strength. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your reasoning power. Love God. All your might. love yourself. See that you don't go to hell. Don't love evil. Don't love the perishing money. Love your soul. You should escape hellfire. Don't love the lust of the youth. Love what is eternal. Love yourself with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your strength, love yourself. Do anything and everything possible that you don't go to hell. Even if you have to cut your hand, cut your hand. If you have to pluck your eyes, pluck your eyes. Love yourself. You should not go to hell. Get a 5 minutes earlier, get a 5 minutes earlier. You want to throw it away something, throw it away. Love yourself, you should not go to hell. You should not go to hell. As you love yourself, love others. Move with compassion. Let your reasonings please God. Let your reasoning, no need to please your mind, your carnality. Let it please God. Let this mind be in you, the mind that was in Christ Jesus. We've got a lot of verses to show you. Let this mind be in you. What is that mind? The mind that was in Christ Jesus. Be spiritually minded. Let all your reasoning capacities be spiritually minded. You've got a reasoning capacity. Reason it out spiritually. Reason it out based on the word of God. My dear brother, my dear sister. And when you want to do something, a ministry or whatever it may be, giving, whatever it may be, do it your best. The Spirit of the Lord has spoken to you. This is the last Sunday morning. There's nothing greater than this in the religion. Loving God, loving yourself, loving others. God bless you.